Okay, so let me start the lecture. Hello everyone, this is Myung Kim. This is seventh week of machine learning application class, right? So before starting, I would like to emphasize we have a quiz 3 today. So which is due on this Sunday, maybe this Sunday, right? So you can check in our Blackboard website. Before starting, I'd like to emphasize one more thing. Please do not copy your friend's one. So it's really, really important. As you know, our quiz is not so difficult, right? So it's just like to check your high-level understanding of our lecture. So try to solve yourself our quiz. So it's really important. 오늘 숙제가 이제 저희가 퀴즈 3이 나갈 거예요. 퀴즈 3이 나갈 거고, 잠시만 채팅 좀 해주겠습니다. 네, 3이 나갈 거고, 이제 우리가 두번 퀴즈 봤죠? 이번 학기에 우리 7번 퀴즈 본다고 그랬는데, 7번을 다 보게 될지 아니면 뭐 중간에 몇 개를 안 볼지는 저 아직 잘 모르겠어요. 우리 이제 진도 나가는 거에 따라 달라질 건데, 당연히 아는 얘기겠지만, 절대 다른 친구들이나 다른 인터넷에 있는 거 베끼지 마세요. 제가 몇번 강조했습니다. 왜 이게 정말 중요한 얘기인데 우리 사실 이제 대학원에 있고 모두 다 바쁘고 사실 그렇잖아요. 그렇죠? 사실 정말 여기 지금 들어와 있는 지금 몇명 들어와 있지? 한 70명 정도 들어오신 분들 일단 너무 감사하고 많이 줄었네요. 네. 정말 다들 바쁘잖아요. 이거 코스웍 듣는 것도 너무 바쁠 거고 석사 과정, 박사 과정, 뭐 통합 과정 다 있을 텐데 그럼에도 시간을 써야 되는 것 같아요. 그럼에도 내가 아무리 일이 바쁘긴 하지만 내가 코스업을 들으면서 뭐라도 얻어가고 싶은 마음이 있으면 시간을 써야 되는 게 맞는 것 같아요. 그쵸? 네. 저희가 수업만 듣고 내가 코스업이 3학점이면 일주일에 3시간? 우린 3시간 다안 하긴 하지만 3시간 다 듣고 이 모든 걸 이해하고 다 따라간다라는 건 사실 불가능에 가깝겠죠? 그쵸? 물론 듣다 보면 안다고 생각할 수 있는 내용들도 많이 있을 텐데 제가 항상 얘기했지만 다시 보고 다시 생각해보고 다시 풀어보다 보면 모르는 것들이 정말 많을 거예요. 그렇기 때문에 꼭 자신의 시간을 들여서 숙제도 풀어보길 바랍니다. 정말 피치 못한 상황 있으신 분들은 저한테 따로 메일을 주세요. 그럼 제가 어떤 이유에서 참작을 해드릴 테니까 우리 정말 학부 학생들도 아니고 정말 대학원 학생들이잖아요. 그쵸? 우리 정말 뭐더 강조 안 하겠죠. 우리 연구자고 연구자의 윤리 뭐다 중요하다는 거다 알잖아요. 그쵸? 정말 중요한 얘기예요. 절대 카피하지 마시고 꼭 본인 시간을 들여서 공부해 보시길 바랍니다. 오케이. So, one more thing is that we don't have the midterm, right? So we in this class we don't have the midterm, but we will have a class. So, please remember, we will have a class at the same time. So if you have a exam at this time, please let me know. Yeah, please let me know. Okay. So today we are going to start the CNN architectures. So before starting, let's recap last week's the convolutional neural network. 잠시만요. 제가 질문이 하나 들어왔는데. 아, 퀴즈 3 얘기는 제가 끝날 때 다시 한번 말씀드릴게요. 이 수업 끝날 때. Okay, so okay, let's start. The last week we introduced the convolutional neural network, right? So 2 weeks ago we introduced 3 weeks ago, yeah, 3 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, yeah. We started the deep neural network, right? So convolutional neural network was the convolutional formulation of the neural network. So yeah, here's that. We consider the image classification problem, which is one of the most challenging problem because the dimension of the input data is so huge, as you can see here. So neural network, the directly using a neural network, no longer feasible. So we need another way to deal with such kinds of challenge data set. Our intuition, it was the local processing of data. So there is two kinds of intuition. The first one is the parameter sharing, and second is sparsity of the connection. So as you can see here, something like the wave data or the image data, the filters that's used for one part of the signal is probably useful in another part of the signal. For example, like this signal and this signal, or this signal. So in convolutional neural network, the kernels are shared across the image or the wave or the 1D vector. And in each layer, each output value depends only on a small number of the input, not a whole input or just a small number of input. So this is the intuition of the convolutional neural network. And we also talked a bit history of the convolutional neural network, right? So yeah, let's not. So today we will just briefly introduce the case study of the convolutional neural network, something like the AlexNet, VGG, LessNet, GoogleNet. So before starting, let's recap. What's the convolution? So comparing to the perceptron, whose weight parameter defined looks like this. So it's really huge. So in convolutional neural network, we'd like to preserve the special structure. So in here, we introduce the filter or corner, right? Filter or corner. So we combine this filter with the image that is the slide over the image specially computing the dot product. Right? So one more thing is that the filter always expand the full depth of the input volume. So the number 3 should be same, right? So it means that we only considering the convolution across the special field, not a depth field. So yeah, so this is the definition of the filter in the convolutional network or just called the convolution layer. So in this case, the one number here, one number is the result of taking a dot product between the filter and small chunk of the data. Small chunk of data, in this case, x prime. So in convolutional neural network, we convolve or slide over full special location, something like this. So it should be noted that each filter are shared, right? So this is the main idea of the convolutional neural network. We also said to train this convolution module, we also have to define the local gradient of the convolution, as we discussed in the last lecture, right? Similar to the neural network. In this class, we will skip this local gradient of the convolution module, but I strongly suggest you try to derive the local gradient of convolution case. It's a little important, okay? And then I also said activation map. So the output of the convolutional module is called the activation map, right? So if you remember our neural network lecture, the activation mapping function was something like the nonlinear map, nonlinear function like sigmoid or the value, but we also call this output as the activation map. Okay, so activation map or convolutional activation map. And then considering the other filter, in this case the green filter, we can make the one more activation map here. So by considering the set of the filter, we can get the separate activation map defined like this. So by stacking the such kinds of the convolution module, of course, we have to employ the activation function, for example, like the ReLU. So one convolution module consisting of the convolution and ReLU. So the parameters looks like this one. So this is a one hidden layer or one hidden output. So in this hidden output, we apply the one more convolution and ReLU function, and by sequentially applying the convolution and ReLU, we can make our network deeper and deeper, right? So this is the main idea of the deep convolution neural network, and here is the visualization of the convolution neural network. In this case, this is the image, right? So this image is size of the 32 by 32 by 3, and the trained filter, the one filter, so something like this one. So one filter generate the one activation map from the input data. So in this case, we have a 32 505 filters. So with each filter, we can make each slice of the activation map, for example, like this one or this one, right? So by stacking this each slice, so we can generate the 28 by 28 by 32 activation map, so which will be the another input activation map to another convolution module, like this one. Okay, so one more thing is that we need a pooling layer which make the representation or the feature representation or the feature activation smaller and more manageable. So it operates over each activation map independently. So very simple examples was the max pooling or the average pooling. Of course, nowadays there are so many other technique that present the more advanced pooling technique, but the max and average pooling is the one of the basic pooling method. So as you can see here, the defined window, we can just pick the representative value as a maximum value or the average value, like this one. So the hierarchy of the convolution layer looks like this. So convolution ReLU pooling, or just have the convolution ReLU, right? So when we visualize the activation map or the kernels, the output is like this. So we can guess that within the deep convolution neural network architecture, there exists the semantic hierarchy from the image, like this one. We also talked about the special dimension of the convolution module, like this one. So we can determine the output. The output special size by considering the input size and filter size and stride. And then, of course, in practice, common to zero path did further. So today we will talk about this one in case study. Anyway, so if there is the p pixel border, then the output size is going to be like this. So this equation and this equation. So deriving these two equations, it's going to be our short quiz 3. So please check this one. Yeah. Okay. So today we are going to move to CN architecture. Okay. So is there any questions so far? So today Okay, before starting, I would like to emphasize that team learning and motion learning, it's not a course that where we should memorize. I mean, you need to understand the concept, but you don't need to memorize every possible, every case of the algorithm. So, 자, 이 부분은 한국말로 한번 설명을 드리면, 이제 오늘은 CNN 아키텍처들에 대해 설명을 드릴 건데, 저번 시간에 간단한 CNN에 대해서 이제는 CNN이 뭐인지 정도 봤고, 이제 조금 디테일한 부분들을 대표적인 CNN 아키텍처들을 보면서 하나하나씩 보려고 해요. 뭐 너무 많은 아키텍처들이 있어 사실 다 보는 건 불가능할 거고, 그래도 대표적이었던, 그러니까 우리가 CNN의 컴퓨터 비전에서 CNN의 발전을 이루었던 대표적인 방법부터 시작해서 한 시대를 풍미했던, 그리고 물론 현재까지도 많이 쓰고 있는 대표적인 네 가지의 CNN 아키텍처들을 배우면서 CNN에서 필요했던 것들을 보려고 해요. 물론 중간중간 이제 디테일한 내용들은 어려울 수도 있을 건데, 첫 번째, 절대 인공지능 머신러닝 또 컴퓨터 비전이라는 과목은 외우는 과목이 아니에요. 그렇죠? 우리가 어렵겠지만 이해를 하는데 시간을 들였으면 좋겠어요. 그쵸? 뭐 컨볼루션 사이즈가 몇이고 이걸 어떻게 했다, 이건 정말 중요하지 않아요. 그러니까 왜 이렇게 했는지, 왜 알렉스넷에서 VG가 갖고 VG에서 글로렛이 나왔고 글로렛에서 레스넷 그 다음에 다른 방법들이 나오고 있는지를 이해하려고 노력을 해봤으면 좋겠습니다. 오케이. So, please try to understand what I mean. So, okay, so let me start. So today we are going to see the four kinds of the representative CNN architecture. The first one is the AlexNet, second is the BridgeNet, the third one is the CuckooNet, and last one is LessNet. Of course, there are so many other variants from this kind of the case representative network, but we just talk about this kind of things today. Okay. So, the starting of the convolutional neural network was the LUNET that I mentioned before. The LUNET was developed by the Yao Li Kun. Yao Li Kun is the director of the Facebook AI research, or just called the Pear Lab now. When he was the graduate student, like you, he developed the LUNET. So, here's the thing. So he tried to solve the character classification problem. So here is the input character like this one, and output it's going to be the multiple class as we discussed previously. And first time he tried to develop a convolutional neural network module to solve this kind of problem. At this initial network, the convolution filter was the 5 by 5 filter applied at a straight one. So it was, as we discussed, it was 5 by 5 filter, and there's the one value here, right? Of course, there is the linear activation mapping, right? And then he applied the subsampling layer. Subsampling layer means the just pooling layer. The subsampling layer was 2 by 2 applied at the straight two. So you can guess the size of the output data. I mean the size of the output data after applying the subsampling pooling layer with 2 by 2 window at straight two. So please think about this one. Anyway, LUNET architecture was something like this one. So FC means fully connected one. So in neural network lecture, we discussed the fully connected network. So
So until this part, this part consisting of the convolution pulling, convolution ReLU pulling, but from here, he just applied the frequency layer. So it was the LUNET. So inspired by this concept, so many methods tried to develop a deep neural network, but there was the successful method until the 2012. But as we discussed, there was the ImageNet large scale visual recognition challenge by Stanford University. So in 2012, there was a very successful network just called the AliceNet. So it was the first CNN-based winner. So the performance gap was really huge and really revolution. So the AliceNet network architecture sounds great. So I guess most of you already know this kind of thing, but let's discuss this one again. So this is the image, input image. In our case, it was the Xn and Yn. So Yn is the 1,000th by one vector, because the in ImageNet classification benchmark, there are 1,000 kinds of the class label. So this is the input and output signal, and he tried to formulate the convolution max pooling, convolution max pooling, convolution 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 max pooling here with a few fully connected module. Let's talk about this one. So first of all, input size is 27 by 3 images. So this is the input size. So in first layer, just called the comb one, 96 by 11 by 11 by filters apply at thread four. So if you remember our previous lecture, here we can just guess the output size
like this. So this is the input size, and this is the filter size 11, and there is a thread 4, but there is no path at this time. So with plus 1, the output size should be 55. So the output volume it's going to be 55 by 55, 96. And total number of the parameters in this layer, it's going to be here. So 11 by 11 by 3, and then we have a 96 this filter. What I mean? To process the 227 images, we need a 11 3 filter, and the number of such kind of filter is 96, right? So the total number of the parameter in this layer is going to be 35,000th parameter. And of course, if we have the bias term, the number of bias is going to be the 96, right? So because there are 96 number of the convolution filter, right? Similar to this kind of thing, it was the first convolution layer.
In second layer, they try to build the pooling layer. In this pooling layer, 3x3 filters applied with a thread two. Actually, we can calculate the output size similar to the convolution case, right? Because the pooling layer also use the sliding window concept, so that we can similarly define the output size in pooling layer. And output volume size should be input size 5x5 and the kernel size 3 with the thread 2 and without padding plus 1, so it's going to be the 27. And the output volume is going to be 27x27x96. So in this pooling case, it's going to be this one, right? The number of parameters in this layer, it's going to be zero, right? There's no runnable parameter. So if you think about this one, okay. So if you remember our previous lecture, to train this kind of the neural network, we need to define a computation graph, right? So, and then we have to compute the local gradient, right? So let's think about this one. So here is the combo one, and we have an input data here, and the let's say the filter W1 and bias P1, right? The size of the filter is going to be 96x3x11x11. Bias is going to be 96. And then output. So let's say HN. So to train this convolution module, the loss gradient with respect to H1 is going to be backpropagated to Xn W1 P1, right? So it's going to be H1 by we should be changing anyway. So this is the backpropagation step in one convolution. In case of the pooling layer, we can similarly draw the one node in computation graph. So it's going to be looks like this. So it's going to be H1 and pool one, and let's say this is output is H2, and there's no runnable parameter here. So H2 H1 it's going to be H1 H2 H2 here's the thing. So in pooling layer, we don't have any runnable parameter. And then similar to this one, input, pooling, convolution, pooling. Of course, there are nonlinear activation function here, maybe ReLU. And there are another modules after that. So finally, we got a full AlexNet architecture. This is a full Latin architecture. Here's the input signal. By using this kind of filter, the output of this module is going to be the 55 by 55 by 96, and after max pooling here, 3 by 3 filter sets straight to, and output is going to be looks like this, right? So blah, 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 blah. Finally, we got a 1,000th neuron, which is going to be the class score, because in image classification, we have the 10 class, 10 class labels.
One more thing is that
we might draw the this output looks like this 55 55 96, but as you can see here,
this kind of the convolution activation was decomposed as a two kinds of things, right?
So it means that
actually this is the figure at the paper, but in this paper there is a two kinds of activation, 5 by 5 by 5 by 4 8 by 2. So there were historical region at the time. They tried to train this kind of the network on the GTX 580 GPU. So with only 3 gigabytes of memory. But at the time it was the state of the most powerful GPU. So but it's not enough. It wasn't enough. So they tried to spread the network across the two GPU, help of the neuron feature map on each GPU. So he trained the network with the two GPU case like this one. By the way, now 2012. Now there is the 3090, right? You know that. So this GPU is going to be distributed. Maybe end of this year. So the memory size of this GPU is going to be 24 gigabytes. I know. So there were dramatically revolution of hardware as well. Okay. So
in this case, convolution 1 here, convolution 2 here, convolution 4 here, convolution 5 here. Connections only with the feature map on the same GPU. So it means that within each GPU, the connection happens. So as you can see here, there is no connection between them. But in convolution 3 here and FC6, FC7, FC8 here, the connection with the world feature map in the preceding layer communicate across the GPUs. So he designed the networks into like this one. And then, yeah, one more thing is that okay, so here, so you can just think about why the output size is looks like this, because in convolution 2 there are 5 by 5 filter, abstract 1 and pad 2, so you can just guess the output size, I mean output spatial resolution as 30 by 30. Okay, so it was the AlexNet. So as I mentioned several times, the ImageNet classification challenge, the AlexNet was making a revolution, something like this one. And then after that, there are one more network like the GFNet, which is the variant of the AlexNet. But after that, in 2014, there was the issue to make a deeper network. Okay, so let's move to this bridge network and Google Net. Okay. So is there any questions so far? 혹시 질문 있으신가요? 어렵지 않죠? 그리고 왜 이렇게 네트워크를 구성했냐고 물어봐도 저도 모르겠어요, 이거는. 그쵸? 아마 요 분, 요 알렉스라는 박사님이 많은 생각을 하고 많은 시행착오 끝에 만들어낸 구조라고 했었고, 근데 결과적으로 너무 잘 됐어요. 너무 엄청난 성공을 거뒀고, 이제 이게 거의 딥 뉴럴 네트워크, 딥 컴프레션 뉴럴 네트워크를 정말로 비전 문제들에 적용할 수 있게 되는 스타팅 포인트가 된 논문이었죠. 그쵸? 자, 그러면서 이제 다른 얘기가 나와요. So, in 2014, there was an issue how to make a deeper network. So, this is the inspiration. Small filters and deeper network. Okay. If you remember AlexNet, the kernel size was the 11 by 11 or the 5 by 5 looks like this. So, it's really huge. 질문이 있으신 것 같은데 초등학생이 네트워크의 종류별로 그래프에서 Y축은 무슨 값인가요? 이걸 아 이거는 이미지나 클래스피케이션 문제니까 그 클래스피케이션 어큐러시겠죠? 클래스피케이션 어큐러시인데 아마 MAP를 잴 거예요. Mean Average Precision을 잴 텐데 그러니까 쉽게 생각하면 클래스피케이션 천 개 중에 하나를 맞춰야 되는데 천 개 중에 하나를 맞출 확률 아, 확률이 아니죠. 이건 어큐러시니까 맞췄는지 틀렸는지를 재는 매저겠죠? 낮을수록 좋을 거예요. The smaller the better. Okay, so 자, okay, so if we go back to our lecture, what was that? Four, we discussed the learning theory. So we said, we talked about the model complexity versus the accuracy, right? So if we increasing the model accuracy, it's going to be prone to overfitting problem. But by increasing the number of training data, we can finally overcome the overfitting problem. So it was the starting point of the deep neural network. Do you remember? So they start to think similar things. So, okay, so as you can see here, the AlexNet has only 8 layers, but the researchers try to develop a more deeper network, like this one, 16 or the 19 layer. So they tried to several kinds of the trial and error, but they just found that with small filter, we can make a network deeper. So here's the idea. Only 3x3 convolutions, thread 1, pad 1, and 2x2 max pooling, thread 2, then we can just improve the AlexNet-based method dramatically, like this. From 11% to the 7%, right? So this is the bridge network. As you can see here, so this is the AlexNet, and there is the VGG16 and VGG19, so it's much deeper, right? And they have the more convolutional module. I mean, convolutional module like this one. 16 means the 16 times the 3x3 convolution, and 19 VGG19 means there exists 19 kinds of the convolution module. Okay, of course the depths of the each module are different, of course, but the special resolution, I mean the special kernel size, was fixed as a 3x3. Why this kind of network was better?
than the Alex Nam. So to understand this kind of thing, we need to think about the relative field. So first question is, why use so smaller filters are better? In this case, 3x3 convolution. So the answers are here. Stack of the three, okay. Stack of the three, 3x3 convolution with the straight one layer has same effective resistive field as one 7x7 convolution layer. One 7x7 convolution layer. So what does it mean? So to understand this, I would like to introduce two more concepts in convolution layer. So first one is the resistive field. Okay. So let's just forget the dimension. I mean the depth dimension. So let's just focus on the spatial dimension in our convolution neural network. Okay. This is the input activation map. And here is the 5x5 by 1 filter to process this activation map. Of course, we can increase the channel like this one, but let's just forget the channel dimension, okay? Because our convolution just happened across the spatial field, not a depth field. So let's just focus on the spatial field. So if we considering the 5y convolution layer, each sliding window should going to be the 5x5, right? So with this 5x5 filter, we can get a one up here. Then we can make a output activation map. Looks like this one. And then if we apply the one more convolutional module defined like the 5x5x1 filter. So in this case, it's going to be 5 and 5. Right? Then this one filter generate the one output here. Up here, okay. So let's focus on this part. So effective resistive field means effective resistive field at this point, it's going to be the 9x9 in input space. Okay, so let's assume that this is the input to generate this one value. This kind of local regions were relative, right? Why? This point generate from this one. So the relevant output, relevant input output. Okay, relevant input. Input data. Okay, so relevant input chunk of data is going to be 9x9. So effective resistive field at this point, it's going to be 9x9. So we can easily derive the rule to calculate the effective resistive field. It's going to be 5 plus 5, 5 is here because there is the 5x5 window, and 5 minus 1, okay? Because they are shared convolution. I mean, okay, shared calculation during the convolution. So it's going to be 5x5, okay? So as you know, the convolution has,결합법칙. 아무튼, 제가 이거 잘 알려줄게요. So if there is a two successive convolution, with the H1 and H2, the final output is going to be X convolution H1 convolution H2, then
we can just represent this convolution as x, x convolution h. So in this case, h, our final convolution, h is going to be h1 convolution by h2. So this is the rule to considering the receptive field. The first of all, larger receptive field are better. The larger receptive field is the better.
Okay, why? Because if we considering the more data, of course we can improve the information extraction. So the larger receptive field are better. One more discussion with the convolution layer looks like this.
Okay, here are same input like this one and this one. Let's think about two kinds of the convolution. The first one is 7x7 convolution layer and 3x3 convolution layer. 3x3 times 3 times C with the three successive convolution. Okay. To understand this, let's assume that the zero padding is applied to preserve the spatial resolution. So,
if you remember the this page, and this page, by using a padding, we can preserve the spatial resolution like this one. Here, right?
So first of all, receptive field are equal.
As we discussed here, we can compute the receptive field for 3x3 convolution layer, in this case 7. So this receptive field of the 7x7 convolution layer is going to be the 7, right? So the receptive field is exactly same in this case.
So
as you can see here, of course,
to determine this value, this, what's that? 7x7 pixels in input data was used, right?
So this is the receptive field. But if you remember this one, we already know the smaller filter, I mean the stack of the smaller filters are better than one large filter. Why? Here's the idea.
The convolution parameter, in this case, it's going to be the 3x3 by C, 1, 2, 3, and three kind of things, and output is going to be C as well. So it's going to be the 27 times C squared. And in this case, the number of the parameter is going to be 94 times the C squared. So this case has a smaller parameter, smaller number of parameter. So if we considering the stack of three times three convolution layer, then we have the same effect of same effective receptive field as a 1 10x7 convolution layer. But as increasing the number of convolution module, we can add it more nonlinearity. So if you remember our previous lecture, after convolution module, we add a nonlinear mapping module. Nonlinear mapping module, right? This one. Nonlinear mapping module. Generally, ReLU. So, due to the this kind of the successive nonlinear mapping function, we can increase the non-linearity of the our network with a fewer parameter from here to here. So that's why the VG network, I mean, this kind of VG network provide the better performance than the previous Alexa paper. Okay, so this is the widget network. Okay, so this is the network architecture of the widget network. It's really complex, right? 질문 있나요? 잠시만요. 아, 오케이. 그, 저 잠깐 물 한 잔만 마실게요. 그, 리셋 앤 필드는, 한글말 설명하면, 그니까 어쨌든 내가 하나의 아웃풋을 만들어내기 위해, 인풋에서 얼마만큼의 픽셀들이 영향을 미쳤느냐, 라고 이해를 해도 괜찮을 것 같아요. 그래서 이 한정을 만들어내기 위해서는, 사실 우리가 이걸 윈도우를 따라가다 보면, 이 9x9개의 이 정보들이 영향을 미쳤잖아요. 그렇죠. 그렇기 때문에 얘 같은 경우 9x9의 리셋 필드가 9x9라고 할 수가 있는 거죠. 그렇죠? 또 다른 생각을 해보면, 그럼 이 점을 제너레이션하기 위해서는 이러한 9x9의 필터가 영향을 미치겠죠. 아, 이러한 9x9의 청커브 인풋이 영향을 미쳤었겠죠. 물론 이 부분들은 다 0이었을 테니까 요 데이터들만이 이 아웃풋 내는데 영향을 주겠죠. 물론 이때 사이즈도 9x9가 될 거고요. 혹시 이해가 되셨나요? 혁준 학생, 이해가 되셨습니까? 네. 잠깐만, 9x9가 아닌가? 9x9가 맞지 않나요? 그러니까 이 한점, 그러니까 그럼 봐봐. 이 한점을 제너레이션하기 위해서는 그 바로 이전의 레이어에서는 이 5x5가 영향을 미쳤다는 거고, 그렇죠? 이 5x5를 만들어내기 위해서 요 인풋에서 어떠한 부분들이 영향을 미쳤느냐만을 계산해 보면 되는 거죠. 그렇죠? 근데 이 5x5를 만들어내기 위해서 요 점은 이 5x5가 만들어냈을 거고, 이 다음 점은 이 옆에 있는 5x5가 만들어냈을 거고, 이 다음 점은 그 옆에 있는 5x5가 만들어냈을 거고, 이걸 쭉쭉쭉 다 계산을 해보면, 쭉쭉쭉 해보면 얘가 9x9가 만들어지겠죠? 아닌가? 맞죠? 다른 학생들 맞나요? 네, 맞죠? 5x5, 맞아요. 자, 물론 그럼 조금 더 생각해 볼 것들이 있겠죠? 만약에 이건 지금 스트라이드가 없는 경우를 계산한 거죠? 패딩도 있고, 패딩은 있고, 스트라이드 없는, 패딩은 상관없고, 스트라이드가 없는 경우인데, 과연 스트라이드가 들어가면 어떻게 내 필드가 바뀔까도 고민을 해보면 좋을 것 같아. 오케이? So, this is the network architecture for the VG network, I mean the VGG16. So if you read the convolutional neural network paper, they usually through the network architecture, like this one. Of course, nowadays, it's impossible to draw the every module in the neural network, deep neural network. So they just to draw something like the VGG here, VGG like this one. But at that time, at 2013, it's very like, it's very like the popular way to, represent their architecture, right? So they represent the input here with the convolution here, right? This one. And they specify, they clarify the number of kernel, I mean the related the kernel size like this one. But nowadays, I mean the in 2020, we use the so huge training, the so huge and so complex network architecture, so it's not possible to draw the such kinds of the network module. So in the paper, I mean the in the recent paper,
they try to, the most researchers try to make a supplementary material things to refer, to clarify the network architecture like this. Okay. Anyway, at the time in VGG 16, they drew the network architecture looks like this. From the input data, there is the two convolution, pooling, convolution, pooling, convolution, pooling, pooling, pooling with the FC layer, similar to the AlexNet. Total memory was the 24 million. To save the one parameter, the 4 byte, I would say 4 byte is needed. So the total memory is going to be the 96 megabyte per image. Of course, the just the one port pass. And this is the memory issue. Memory issue. So this memory is related to the activation map. Activation map. And the parameter, number parameter is related to the kernel size. Kernel size. So the total parameter is going to be the 138 million parameter. Right? So as you can see here, most memory in all the combo. Here, because the spatial resolution is nearly huge at the first early convolution layer, but as increasing the number of convolution, the spatial resolution is going to be smaller. Yeah, like from 222 to the 112, 56, 28, 14, and 1 by 1. And of course, the most parameters are in late FC here. As we discussed previously, the FC means the neural network. So if the data is really huge, in this case, like 512, then one FC layer, it looks like this one, it's really huge. So most parameters in late FC module. So it was the VG network, but of course, most recent neural network, I mean the convolution neural network, try to remove this FC part because they demand the huge parameter, let's say, huge parameter to say, parameter memory, right? So of course, to save the parameter, we need to preserve the memory, but yeah, it's not feasible anymore. So most recent one try to remove the such kinds of the FC layer. Okay. Of course, it was the VG network. Yeah. And then so far we discussed until VG network. So before keep going, let's take a 10-minute break and let's move to the Google Lab. Okay. Okay, so already, so let's do that. After Bridge Network, there was one more network just called the Google Lab. Google Lab. Actually, Google Lab was also proposed in 2014, the same years as the BridgeNet. The intuition was similar, the deeper network with the computation efficiency. In Google Lab, the authors used 22 layers with the efficient inception module. I will introduce this one later. Anyway, they tried to remove the efficient layer, and only 5 million parameters, 12 times less than the AlexNet. So it was the winner of the ImageNet classification, the ImageNet visual recognition challenge. So this is the right-hand side. We can see the Google Lab architecture. Look at this. Each module in Google Lab consisting of the inception module. Okay, so what is that? Let's think about this one. So inception module design a good local network topology. It's like the network in a network within a network. Then stack this module on top of each other. So, as you can see here, from previous layer, the previous activation map, they, instead of using just one branch, like this one, like the previous method, like Fuji or AlexNet, they try to use the multiple branch, like this one. And then this parameters independently defined and updated independently. And then this information, this activation map concatenated to the next layer. So this is the idea was the inception module. Why this inception module was better than the just a single path. There are several kinds of reasons, but the main reason is that with the different kinds of paths, we can learn the different property of this information. So what I mean? Okay, so if we just considering this module have the limited capacity to extract the information from the previous layer. But if we can formulate the multiple branch layers like this one, they try to learn the different aspect from the previous layer to improve or to maximize the output classifier performance. So that's the idea of the inception module. Actually, this is the very similar concept of the ensemble. So in machine learning, before the deep neural network, there was very popular technique to improve the machine learning performance by aggregating the different case of the model. So this inception module has similar impact of the ensemble technique in the machine learning field. Anyway, so by using an inception module, the Google Lab Google Lab improved the performance comparing to the previous method and the previous architectures. So the idea in manner we use the multiple branch like this one can be realized
in left hand side things like this one.
We can apply the parallel filter operations on the input from previous layer, right?
The parallel filter operation, I mean the this one, this one, and this one, this one. No, actually, this is the pooling layer, so there is no non-normal parameter. So there are three kinds of path.
By formulating the, I mean by changing the size of the convolution kernel,
we can extract the okay. We can considering multiple relative field size for the convolution. For example, like 1 by 1, 3 by 3, 5 by pi, with the pooling operation 3 by 3. And then we can just concatenate whole filter output or just activation map together depth wise. I mean the together depth wise. So together depth wise means like this one and this one. Okay. Let's say this is the red one. And we can just concatenate two, one, like this one and this one. So very easy. So this is one of the possible way to fuse the multiple output from the previous layer, right? Then what is the problem with this? What is the problem with this? Let's think about this one. The question is, what are the output size of the filter concatenation? What are the output size of the filter concatenation? To simplify this, let's assume that the proper size of the zero padding was used. So let's say that our input of the inception module, this inception module, was the 28 by 256, and let's use the 1 by 1 by 128 combo, 3 by 3 by 192 combo, 5 by 5 by 96 combo, right? As you know, the output of this convolution module is going to be looks like this. Right. More specifically, the kernel size is going to be
그 제가 저번에 했지만 이 텐서의 순서는 별로 정말 중요하지 않아요. 규칙만 있으면 돼요. 그러니까 로우가 먼저 써지냐, 뎁스가 먼저 써지냐, 뭐 이제 배치라는 개념도 나올 텐데 지금 배치까지 얘기 안 했죠? 커널 사이즈 그리고 그러니까 인풋 커널, 아웃풋 커널 사이즈를 지금 1, 2, 8, 2, 5, 6인데 이 순서는 별로 중요하지 않아요. 왜냐면 우리가 리시엡을 다 할 수 있는 거죠. 그러니까 텐서라는 건 어쨌든 사실 하나의 벡터라고 생각해도 된다고 했죠. 근데 그거를 우리가 리시엡을 해서 매트릭스 만들 수 있고 볼륨도 만들 수 있고 점점 바꿀 수 있는 거니까 디멘션을 늘리는 거에만 차이가 나는 거니까. Anyway, in this case, output is going to be the 28 by 128. And this one, and this one. So, as you can see here, the output size is going to be looks like this. So this one, like this. As comparing with this one, okay, let's think about the convolution operation. Here, we have a module input. 28 by 1 by 256
number of operation. I mean the it's going to be the parameter multiplication, right? Anyway, it's really really huge.
왜 이렇게 나오는지 이해되시죠? 우리 지금까지 계속 얘기했던 건데 이런 액티베이션 맵을 얘 사이즈가 2828 256 되는 거를 뭐야 1 by 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 1 by
맞나? 128번, 그쵸. 이게 슬라이딩 윈도우를 돌아야 되니까 이러한 계단 내에 나오는 거죠.
정말 계단 내에 많아지죠?
Of course, the single case is fine, right? The single compressor case is fine, but if we're considering the two more branch, like the 3x3 convolution or the 5x5 convolution, the compressor operation is going to look like this, then the total number of the convolution operation is going to be the 854 million operation. So of course this is very expensive to compute. The pooling layers preserve the feature depth, I mean here. So even though we use the even though we apply the pooling layer, the the number of depth still preserved, right? We just assume that the pooling happened within the special window, narrow depth window. So total depth after concatenation can only grow at every layer, right? So that's going to be the problem. So in this paper, they introduce the solution, just called the Bartholin layer. So Bartholin layer, what is Bartholin layer? Bartholin layer use the 1x1 convolution to reduce the feature depth. So in Bartholin layer, main concern was the depth, because this one. So they try to reduce this feature depth. Okay, let's think about how. To this end, they are considering the 1x1 convolution. So this is the input activation map, 56 by 64. Then let's think about 1x1 convolution with a 32 filter. So in this case, 32 by 64 times 1x1. So just one filter, 1x1 by 64, it's going to be combo like this one. Each filter has the size 1x1 by 64 and perform a 64 dimensional dot product at each time. Right? Then output is going to be like this. So first of all, they have a input and output activation maps have a same spatial resolution as a 56, but they have a different depth information. I mean the different feature depth. So this is the main idea of the Bartholin layer. Okay, so by using such kind of the bottleneck concept, they improve the naive inception module. It's an inception module with a dimension reduction here. So this is the input, I mean, this is the previous layer, and people applying larger corner, they first apply the 1x1 convolution to reduce the feature depth. I mean the dimension of the feature depth. Like this. Here, and here. So this is called the bottleneck layer. So let's think about the mass. I mean, let's think about the dimension. So input is still 28 by 256. Of course, this one is the same, but by introducing the bottleneck layer here, we first reduce the feature dimension as 64. And then we can apply the same size of the kernel, like the 3x3 or the 5x5, then the output, it's going to be, looks like this one, and then this is our filter concatenation output. So comparing to the previous
previous example here.
One by 64 combo here have the convolution operation like this one and this one, and where is that? And this one is here, right? This one is, where is that? Here. This one is here, and one more button layer here, right?
Of course, as you can see here, they might have the more convolutional module, but the total number of the operations was smaller than the previous one.
So compared to the previous number of operation for the neighbor version, the bottleneck, I mean, these three kinds of the bottleneck module can also reduce the depth after pooling layer, right?
So this is the idea to reduce the computation time in Google Lab. Okay, so this is the pool Google Lab architecture. It looks complicated, but it's not complicated anymore.
Okay, so this is input, this is output, and they have the stem network. I mean, just like the plane network, combo pooling, and in the middle of network, they have the stack the inception module that we discussed so far, and of course they have a classifier output. In here, they remove the expansive epoxy layer, right?
So if you remember
this one, epoxy layer have the so many runoff parameter, so it's not desirable.
So in Google Math, they remove or eliminate the epoxy layer, right?
And interestingly, they also have the two more output. I mean, they have a auxiliary classification output to inject the additional gradient at low layer. So something like this.
So what does it mean?
Let's think about this one. Okay,
so let's think about this figure as a computation graph. Okay, so let's assume that we want to train this network. So it means that we have to update the runoff parameter at each branch, I mean each module.
So for example, let's say there is a WI here. To train this one, here is the loss function. Then let's say the final one, the final
activation parameter,
let's say P. Then loss gradient with respect to the P should be backpropagated until WI. So backpropagation happens, looks like this one. Of course, there are so many paths to give a gradient loss like this one.
But we will discuss this one next week, but to backpropagate the loss gradient,
of course we have to use the local gradient, right, at each branch.
But as if the network are getting deeper, there is going to be the gradient vanishing problem.
So
it might be undesirable to train this one.
So to
solve this kind of problem, they introduced two more layer like this one.
And let's say this is P1. Then they try to augment the loss gradient from this backpropagation path like this one. So we can get a more accurate gradient with respect to the auxiliary classifier in Google Math. Okay, so this is the idea of using auxiliary classification.
In total, there are 22 layers with weight. Parallel layers count as one layer, two layer per inception module, then
We didn't count the auxiliary output layer. So anyway, we have a 22 total layer in Google, full Google architecture. Is there any question so far? Is there any question? 별로 어렵지 않죠? 이건 약간 뭐랄까 역사에 대해 배우는 시간이라고 생각해도 될 것 같아. 생각했죠? 외울 필요 전혀 없고 왜 인셉션이 왜 저렇게 되는지 VGG를 왜 3x3으로 올려서 뎁스 늘렸는지 이 부분들을 이런 것들을 좀 집중적으로 봤으면 좋겠어요. Okay. So far, we discussed the level, evolution of the deep convolutional neural network, and then the number of, let's think about the number of layers. So in AlexNet, they have the N layers. In VGG network, they have 90 layers. In GoogleNet, they have 22 layers. But the researchers start to think about how about increasing the depth? I mean, the how about increasing the number of the layer in deep convolutional neural network? So this less neural network is a starting point of the resolution of the depth in CNN. Okay, let's think about what it means. Okay, the LessNet. We are going to talk about LessNet. The intuition cell looks like this. So in LessNet, the authors try to make a very deep network, something like 150, like this one, using the residual connection. Okay, let's think about what it means. So, but before that, this is the LessNet architecture. The interesting things are here. Each input and output module are connected like this one. So we can formally represent this one. So this is the residual block. The X is the input activation map. And output activation maps are here. Rather than using a plain convolution, like this, they try to use the one more pass, like this one, with the summation. So this is the single module of in residual network. Okay, from now on, let's think about why this residual networks are a better choice to make our network deeper. Okay, people keep going. Okay, so in LessNet, they use the 152 layers model for ImageNet, and this paper was the winner in ImageNet classification challenge in 2015. They swept the old classification and detection competitor in this ImageNet classification challenge. Okay, let's think about what it means. Okay, so question was something like this. What happens when we continue stacking deeper layer on a plain convolutional neural network? Okay, what happens when we continue stacking deeper and deeper layer on a plain convolutional neural network? Looks like this. Input, convolution activation, convolution activation. Of course, we can use the multiple branch like this one, as in GoogleNet, or output, right? Many researchers try to increase the number of convolutional layer, but such kinds of phenomena happen. So here is the case of the 20 layers, and here is the case of the 56 layer. Of course,
we can just expect that 56 layer would going to be better, right? It's going to be better. But interestingly, when we increased the iteration,
20 layer was better
in training and testing. Training and testing. Okay. Let's think about this one. So in terms of the model complexity, 56 layer case would be better, right? This model would be much complex. But when we train this network with very large scale data, so something like the ImageNet data set,
this kind of phenomena
was observed. Okay, so we can think about several kinds of things.
So, okay, this is a fact. 56 layer models perform the worst on both training and testing error. So it means that the deeper model perform worse, but interestingly, it's not a caused by overfitting problem.
Okay, so if you remember our lecture 4, if there is an overfitting problem, the training error should be smaller than the 20 layer case. But in this case, 56 layer case is the worse than 20 layer case, even in training and testing page, right? So we can assume that it's not an overfitting problem. So why this problem happened? This is a fact. Thin model have more representation power, the more parameter than the shallow model, right? So that's why the thin network success in many applications. So from this observation, we can just make a hypothesis that the problem is not about optimization, but it's related to the optimization, not model itself. Okay, so we can just assume that it's not an overfitting problem. So the question is, the deeper models are harder to optimize. So our goal should be something like this: how to optimize our deeper model better than previous one. Okay, so how to optimize our networks are better than plain case one. So this is a starting point of the legendary network, team legendary network. 이 부분 한국말로 한번 설명을 더 한번 하고 넘어갑시다. 별로 어려운 얘기는 아니지만 그러면 또 재밌는 것 같아요. 정말 재밌는 것 같아. 무슨 얘기를 하고 싶었던 거냐면, 이제는 사람들이 딥러닝의 시작에서 했던 얘기가 뎁스를 늘리면, 네트워크의 컨볼루션 개수를 늘리면 점점 좋아지는 것들이 보여지는 거죠. 여기까지 봤더니 뭐 8개에서 19개 늘렸다, 22개로 늘렸으니까 좋아지는 걸 확인을 했어. 그러니까 그러면 우리가 점점점 늘리면 더 좋아지는 거 아니냐. 뭐 컴퓨테이션 타임은 계속 좋아질 거고, 그럼 영원히 늘리면 더 무한히 가까워지면서 점점 좋아지는 게 아니냐라는 생각을 당연히 하겠죠. 그러면서 이제 실험을 해봤는데, 56개 레이어와 20개 레이어를 똑같은 상황에서 실험을 해봤는데 정말 신기하게 20개 레이어가 더 잘 되는 거야. 그래서 이제 모델이 복잡해서 오버피팅이 일어났다면은 사실 트레이닝 에러는 얘가 더 좋아야 됐었죠. 근데 트레이닝도 안 되는 거야. 그렇죠? 그렇기 때문에 사람들이 생각을 하는 거죠. 자, 우리는 이제 그런 어떤 페노메나 또는 팩트를 받고 이거를 이제 어떻게 풀까에 대한 고민들을 하기 시작했던 거죠. 자, 그래서 모델의 캐패시티가 문제였다면 사실 오버피팅이 났어야 되는 건데, 오버피팅 문제가 아니니까 옵티마이즈의 문제일 거다. 우리가 지금까지 했었던 플레인 컨볼루션들을 그냥 백프로파이션을 옵티마이즈를 했을 때 생기는 문제일 거라고 생각을 하기 시작한 거죠. 물론 이 레스넷이 첫 번째 페이퍼는 아니에요. 그런 생각을 한 첫 번째 페이퍼는 아니지만 그거를 정말로 구현을 해서 실제로 이거를 성공시킨 페이퍼라서 의미가 있었던 거죠. 오케이. So, 그래서 이제 여기서 레슨에서 이제 아이디어가 시작됩니다. 그래서 오케이. So the deeper model should be able to perform at least as well as the shallow one. Right? So deeper model should be able to perform at least as well as the shallow one. Why? Because we have the enough number of data. Enough number of data, right? So they found the solution. A solution by construction is copying the learned layer
copying the learned layer from the shallower model and setting additional layer to the identity mapping. Okay, let's think about what it means. Okay, here's the idea. Use the network layer to fit residual mapping instead of directly trying to fit a desirable underlying mapping. Okay, what does it mean? Okay, let's think about original convolution block. Here is the input data, x. Then output after two successive convolution module, it's going to be the HW. So in this plain module, or the original convolution block, they try to learn the HX, right? They directly try to fit the desirable underlying function with these two convolution module, right? But instead of this one, in deep neural network, they use the identity mapping like this one. Okay, so in this case, the output of this residual block is going to be the fx plus x. So x is here, input data itself, and fx is the learned function. So in this case, our residual net trying to train the residual, this fx like this. So use this kind of the layer, we can fit the residual fx equal to hx minus x instead of the hx directly in the plane convolution. So if there is an identity mapping case, then fx is equal to zero. So this one is going to be zero. Then the output is going to be x itself. So this is the main architecture formulation of the deep neural network. Why this one is better? It is related to this gradient vanishing problem. So if we considering this original block, the loss gradient is going to be backpropagated, looks like this one, right? So due to the sum properties of the convolutional module, this gradient might be reduced or the vanished, right? So that is called the gradient vanishing problem. But if we considering this shortcut, that's called the identity path, the loss gradient can be flow to this way, right? So even though gradient vanishing happens in the fx, then this original loss gradient is successfully flow to the input data, right? The input branch, so we can reduce the gradient vanishing problem, and then we can dramatically improve the number of the convolutional module with this residual block. Okay, so this is the one reason of the success of the residual network. And one more thing is that within the network, some module might not be necessary. If you think about this one, for example, this one might not be necessary. So in some case, we might need to connect directly to this one without this module. But if we considering the original convolution block, we cannot learn the identity mapping case. So, but by using the residual block, we can easily train. We can easily learn the identity mapping case.
아, 이 부분 한국말로 한번 더 설명을 할게요. 자, 제가 이제 두 가지를 얘기를 했습니다. 두 가지 얘기를 했는데, 그러니까 레슨넷이 성공을 했던 이유, 레슨넷으로 뎁스를 뭐 150위까지 늘렸던 이유에 대해서 두 가지의 측면에서 첫 번째 그래디언트 베니시 프로블럼을 줄일 수 있었고, 그래디언트가 바로 이제 아이덴티티 매핑으로 빠져나올 수 있으니까 그래디언트 베니시 프로블럼을 줄일 수가 있었고, 어떤 레이어들, 즉 우리가 150개의 레이어를 쌓긴 하겠지만 어떤 프로블럼에서는 저 150개의 레이어가 전부 다 아웃풋에 영향을 주지 않길 바랄 수도 있어요. 그렇죠? 예를 들어서 이 레이어 같은 경우는 사용을 안 하고 싶을 수도 있어요. 오히려 사용 안 했을 때 성능이 더 좋아질 수도 있는데, 이렇게 플레인 네트워크에서는 그 레이어가 사용이 안 된다는 측면에서는, 그러니까 무슨 얘기냐, HX가 X 자체로 나오려면은 이 모듈에서, 이 모듈에서 HX가 X가 나오도록 하는 아이덴티티가 학습이 돼야 되는 거예요. 그렇죠? 아이덴티티라는 거는 매트릭스 생각하면 그냥 요게 학습이 되어야 되는 거죠. 그렇죠? 그런데 레슨넷에서는 사실 얘를 빵으로 만들면 끝나는 거죠. 그렇죠? 사실 요 컨볼루션이 아이덴티티를 배우는 게 쉽냐? 제로를 배우는 게 쉽냐? 보면 제로를 배우는 게 훨씬 쉽겠죠. 그렇죠? 컨볼루션의 커널들이 모두 빵이면 그냥 9시 빵이니까 아이덴티티를 배우는 거는 훨씬 쉬운 문제일 거예요. 그렇기 때문에 레슨넷이 기존 플레인 네트워크들에 비해서 어떤 그래디언트 베니시 프로블럼과 어떤 아이덴티티 매핑 프로블럼 관점에서 성능을 매우 향상시켰고, 그러므로써 이제 우리가 레볼루션 오브 뎁스, 그러니까 컨볼루션의 크기를 거의 무한히 가까이 늘릴 수가 있게 되었다 라는 거죠. 자, 이게 레슨에서 이제 메인 키 아이디어였고요. So is there any question so far? 어렵지 않죠? 어렵지 않죠? 정말 어려운 것들도 이제 다 지나갔습니다. 자, 이제 마무리 해봅시다. So, the full lesson and architecture, I will write this. So, they have the stacked residual block. This one, this one, this one, and this one. Every residual block have a 2 3x3 convolution, something like this one, this one, with the identity connection. With the summation, right? This is the main architecture formulation of the listener. So, from input signal, they periodically double shove of the number of filter and downsample the specially using stride 2. 무슨 얘기냐면 필터의 그러니까 depth는 두 배로 늘리면서 계속 스페셜 레졸루션을 뭐라고 하죠? 반으로 줄이는 거죠. 오케이? 자, depth는 늘리면서, 근데 depth만 늘리면 스페셜 레졸루션 계속 있으면 너무 무겁잖아. 사실 아까 얘기했지만 스페셜 레졸루션이 메모리에 제일 큰 영향을 미치니까 VGG에서 생각을 해보면 요 파트였죠. 그래서 우리는 스페셜 레졸루션을 계속 줄였어야 되는 거고, 근데 스페셜 레졸루션을 줄이면서도 인포메이션은 잘 익스트랙션을 해야 되니까 이 뎁스는 늘리는 거죠. 이 뎁스는 그래서 64를 128로 늘리고 쭉쭉쭉 늘려나는 거죠. 물론 이제 마지막에선 줄였겠죠. 어디까지 늘리다가. 그리고 네. What else? Yeah.
And they use the additional combo layer at the beginning. So in the at the beginning, they use the
7x7 convolution module to reduce the special resolution dramatically. So,
this one. And they didn't use the FC layer beside the final one, because we need the final one to predict the output class. And they used the global average pooling after the last convolution layer. Global average pooling looks like this one. So, reduce the special resolution as a 1x1. Okay, so this is the global average pooling. Average pooling layer.
Okay, so this is a full architectural design of the deep residual network. Okay. So, comparing to the VG network or the Google net, the total number of the layer was the 18
34, 15, 101, and 152 layers. So we just call this way, this kind of layer at less than 18, less than 34, something like this. Okay. One more thing is that similar to the inception net, they also use the bottleneck layer. They also use the bottleneck layer to improve the efficiency. So ideas are here. Rather than directly use the 3x3 convolution layer, they use the 1x1 convolutional layer at the beginning to reduce the depth of the input data, I mean the depth of the input activation map, 236 to the 64. And then they apply the 3x3 convolution operation here, and there is one more convolution layer, I mean the 1x1 convolution layer to project back to the original depth of the input data, Why? We have to add the output up here with the input data. So this is the residual network with the block bottleneck layer. So for the deeper network, maybe less than 50 plus, I mean the this one, they generally use the bottleneck module to reduce the depth of the network. I mean the depth of the activation map. Okay. So, is there any question? 제가 목이 좀 아파서 물 좀 마시면서 할게요. 죄송합니다. 질문 있나요? 어렵지 않죠? 오늘 것도 언제나 그랬듯이 어렵지 않습니다. 오케이. So if you don't have question, I will keep going. So very interestingly, this residual network developed by the Kai-Ming Ha, which is the research scientist in Facebook Research AI Lab, Pell Lab now. This residual network paper was the CBPR 2015 paper. Of course, this was the best paper. This paper got the best paper award in the CBPR 2016. The CBPR is the top tier conference in the computer vision field. Anyway, so this the ResNet is the most cited paper in whole area in Google Scholar Matrix 2012. So it's very powerful. Nowadays, most of the vision technique, I mean the vision application, generally use the ResNet as a backbone network because it is the cheaper and powerful. So vision, language, speech, AlphaGo, they all those methods are based on the residual network. Okay? So it's very 이 얘기를 조금 하고 넘어가면 좋을 것 같아요. 그 이제 저 카이밍어 박사님이 2016년도 이제 이 페이퍼가 나왔어요. 그러니까 물론 뭐 연구나 2015년도 전에 했겠죠. 근데 1년 정도 했겠죠. 그래서 이제 CBPR을 냈고 엄청난 성공을 거뒀죠. 사실 뭐 우리가 현존하는 지금 모든 에리아에서 사실 작년도 재작년도도 마찬가지고 기준으로 가장 사이트가 많이 된 페이퍼가 이 페이퍼로 하니까 아마 정말 많이 임팩트가 있는 페이퍼였던 것 같아요. 사실 아이디어는 어렵지 않았잖아요. 아이디어는 어렵지 않았지만 그만큼 임팩트가 있었던 거죠. 그래서 이분이 사실 이 페이퍼를 쓸 때가 사실 마이크로소프트 아시아 베이징에 있는 곳에서 이제 사실 연구원이셨어요. 그래서 제가 2016년 2학기 때 9월에 이제 MSRA에서 마이크로소프트 리서치 아시아에서 인턴을 했었는데 그때 저분이 거의 계셨었거든요. 저희 옆 팀이셨는데 사실 잘 몰랐어요. 그래서 근데 어느 날 이제 뭐 사내 공지 메일 같은 게 이제 오는데 레스넷이라는 게 나왔는데 현존하는 모든 챌린지에서 다 우승을 했다라는 거예요. 그래서 뭐 이제 우리가 다음 시간 보겠지만 뭐
인지 클래시피뿐만 아니라 디텍션, 뭐 세그멘테이션 모든 분야에서 다 1등을 했다라는 거예요. 그래서 2015년 그죠? 이건 15년 2학기였으니까 그래서 그 당시에만 해도 딥러닝이 그렇게까지 성공을 많이 거두지 못했던 시기고 12월에 나오던 페이퍼들이 반절은 딥러닝을 쓰고 반절은 딥러닝을 안 쓰던 정도의 시대였고 저도 개인적으로 아 딥러닝을 써야지 하면서 이제 좀 해봐야겠다라는 시기였는데 뭐 그런 얘기들이 나오기 시작하더라고요. 그래서 말이 많았죠. 아 카이미호가 누구냐 하는데 식당을 이제 가요. 저희가 밥을 먹을 식당을 가면 저 카이미호 박사님이 저가 거기서 리서치 사이언티스트였는데 그 MSRA에서 자기 팀 인턴들이랑 항상 밥을 먹으러 오더라고요. 한 두세 명 정도? 그래서 맨날 밥을 먹으러 와서 그래서 저기 맨날 보여요. 아, 저 사람이 카이미호다 이런 사람들이 막 얘기를 하기 시작하는데 그래서 보면은 항상 심각해. 보면은 중국어로 하니까 뭔 말인지 모르겠는데 뭐 우리랑 비슷한 얘기를 할 것 같아. 밥 먹으면서 아 이제 무슨 연구를 해야 되나 뭐 이런 얘기를 할 것 같아. 하는 것 같아. 그리고 그런가 보다 하고 있었죠. 그러더니 CVPR 학회가 시작됐고 공개가 되고 세상이 바뀌기 시작하더니 저분이 다시 페이스북으로 가시더라고요. 어찌됐든 그렇게 시작된 페이퍼가 물론 저분이 뭐 이 레진넷 페이퍼 전에도 뭐 가이드드 필터라든지 많은 굵직굵직한 연구들 많이 하셨지만 이 페이퍼를 기점으로 해서 정말로 이제 컴퓨터 비전 인공지능 분야에서 정말 세계적인 연구자가 되셨고 정말 지금도 잘하고 계세요. 그래서 정말 지금도 나오는 굵직굵직한 페이퍼들 뭐 셀프 슈퍼바이즈 러닝이나 비전 쪽에서도 그런 페이퍼들이 다 이제 저분이 작성을 하고 계시고 무슨 얘기를 제가 하고 싶었냐면은 오늘 좀 길게 얘기를 했는데 사실 레스넷도 중요하지만 요걸 좀 생각을 해봤으면 좋겠어요. 이제 우린 대학원생들이잖아요. 어쨌든 어떠한 식으로 연구자의 길을 가려고 온 사람들이고 많은 생각들을 하면서 우리가 연구자의 길을 가고 있잖아요. 지금 석사생들도 있을 거고 통합과정 하시는 분들도 있을 거고 박사과정들도 있을 거예요. 여러분들이 이 길을 갈 때 먹었던 마음가짐도 다 다를 거고 지금 생각하고 있는 마음들 뭐 졸업 후에도 본인들이 생각하는 길이 다 다를 거예요. 그렇죠? 우리가 어떠한 삶을 살게 될 것인가 연구자의 길을 간다라는 게 무엇인가에 대해서 고민을 해봤으면 좋겠어요. 우리가 많은 이유로 여기에 와 있긴 하지만 저는 그렇게 생각해요. 이 페이퍼를 보면서 뭔가 다른 분야의 사람들이 들으면 웃을 수도 있겠지만 우리는 세상을 바꾸고 있는 거죠. 자, 다른 솔직히 너무 거창하고 저도 아직 바꾸지 못했지만 저는 솔직히 이 페이퍼는 세상을 바꿨다고 생각하거든요. 이 페이퍼 정도면은 페이퍼로서의 가치를 뛰어넘어서 정말 세상을 바꾸고 있어요. 왜냐하면 이 페이퍼 이후로 나오는 모든 알고리즘들 컴퓨터 뭐 오제 디텍션이나 이런 알고리즘들까지 다 실생활 다 쓰이고 있잖아요. 지금 웬만한 네트워크들이나 웬만한 아키텍처는 다 이 모듈들이 들어가고 있거든요. 그래서 우리는 세상을 바꾸는 일을 하고 있다라는 자부심을 좀 가졌으면 좋겠어요. 물론 내가 지금 한 연구는 내가 논쓴 페이퍼는 래퍼 한 번도 안 되고 어둠 속에 사라질지도 모르겠지만 그 조각조각들이 모이다 보면 언젠가 이렇게 레스넷 같은 세상을 바꾸는 페이퍼를 우리도 쓸 수 있지 않을까 뭔가 세상에 이런 일을 할 수 있지 않을까 그렇게 하도록 노력을 하는 게 우리가 해야 될 뭐랄까 책임감이자 우리가 여기에 있는 이유라고 생각을 해요. 그래서 얘기가 좀 길어졌는데 정말로 저는 이 얘기를 여러분들 지금 대학원생들 지금 이제 연구를 시작하려는 연구자의 길을 가려는 여러분들에게 해주고 싶었어요. 오케이? 네, 그 얘기를 해주고 싶었고 사실 레스넷에 대해 이해하는 건 별로 중요하지 않아요. 어렵지도 않고 그렇죠? 어렵지도 않죠? Okay, so this is a summary of the CN architectures in the image net classification problem. So, after 2012, there was a revolutionary, papers in deep neural network. I mean, the deep neural network in image classification problem. Okay, so in this paper, in this survey paper, they compared the proposed papers until
2017, the accuracy was increased. This looks like this one, right? And they also compared to the operation or the computation complexity in x-axis and accuracy in y-axis, like this one. So AlexNet is here. So Alex was a starting point, right? So AlexNet, smaller compute, and still memory heavy, and lower accuracy. And Google Lab was the most efficient at the time, I mean the, in 2017 here. And ResNet, moderate efficiently depending on the model, highest accuracy here. And VGG was not so bad, but it required the highest memory and most operation due to the FC layer, if you remember previous slide. Anyway, so we can think about which network architectures is going to be better in your application. So of course they comparing the port time per image and network power consumption, right? So it's not important. Okay, so after that, okay, I will introduce two more paper and then finish. Of course, there are so many variants of the ResNet, right? So we cannot say all of everything, right? Because there are so many papers. But I would like the two more papers. The first one is the Skijian excitation network. Okay, then excitation network in 2017. The network architecture was looks like this one, and they add the feature recalibration module that learn the adaptively relate the feature map, something like this. This is the one activation map, but they want to recalibrate the input feature across the channel. The channel or the depth axis. So to this end, they first use the global average pooling to get the this activation map, and then they use the one more, additional convolutional module to compute this kind of attention. I said this is the attention, channel attention. And then they apply this channel attention to the input activation map. Then generate these kinds of things. Okay, so this is the improved the version of the residual network, but this paper also have a meaning that they introduced the attention concept across the channel axis. One more paper was the DenseNet, densely connected convolutional network. Okay, so this one is a plain CNN, like this one. This one is a ResNet. They just connect the input and output like this one. But in DenseNet, each modules are connected to each other like this one. So they densely connected each other. So this is the main idea of the DenseNet. So it was also got the best paper award in CBPR 2017. This paper also dramatically improved the gradient management problem, because this loss gradient is directly connected to the input layer, like this one. So the dense blocks, where each layer is connected to each other layers in feedport fashion. So this paper dramatically elevate the vanish gradient problem and strengthen the feature propagation and increase the feature reuse stasis. Okay? Can understand what I mean? Okay, so this is the end of today's lecture. From last week, we discussed the convolutional neural network and CNN architecture. And next week, we will talk about how to train such kinds of the network. I mean, something like the technique. For example, batch normalization or the optimization technique or the initialization technique, something like that. Okay? So this is the end of today's lecture. Thank you very much. See you
next week. Oropji anayo, geunde. 자, 왜 저도 어려울 것 같긴 한데 이게 정말 어쩔 수 없는 것 같아. 대학원 수업이기 때문에 제가 정말 하나하나 설명하는 것보다 하이레벨로 보여주고 여러분들이 한 번 더 보는 게 맞는 것 같아요. 그렇죠? 정말 더 중요한 거는 페이퍼 읽어봐요. 오늘 다뤘던 페이퍼 해봤자 6개 안 되잖아요? 페이퍼를 다시 한번 읽어보고 제가 했던 말과 다시 한번 매핑을 해보는 게 정말 도움이 많이 될 거예요. 왜냐하면 이제 우리가 연구를 한다는 측면에서는 강의에서 배우지 못하는 거거든요. 그렇죠? 그렇기 때문에 페이퍼에서 의미를 찾는 연습을 하는 것도 매우 중요할 겁니다. Okay, so is there any questions so far? If not, let's finish and see you next week.